Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
If you want, Mom, what?
We got to see.
Okay, are we ready, guys? Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to our June 6th meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. And before we begin, I'm going to ask my friend Roger Parker here if he will do our invocation for us.
Okay, let's play, Chris. Dear God, I want to thank you for another beautiful day. Wake up in this wonderful country of the United States of America. Dear God, we thank you for all the many blessings that you bestow upon us. We ask that you be with our military at home and abroad and bring them all home safely. Be with our law enforcement officers as they do their duties, bring them home safely. Dear God, be with us today as we conduct business for Alamance County. Forgive us our many sins. These things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
And let's do the Pledge of Allegiance, if we could, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And before we start, I understand there's a gentleman in our presence that's put together something for our armed forces. Mr. Tillman, if you will come forward, I got a little something I would like to recognize you with, and you can tell us about these brochures you're handing out. How are you, sir? On behalf of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, I want to express our sincere appreciation to you for organizing an event to honor men and women who have served and presently serving in our armed forces. Again, please accept our utmost gratitude for your commitment in organizing this project. And with that, I'm going to let you tell us about it.
Thank you,
that's
sir.
Yours to have.
Thank you very much. May I just give each of these? Thank you so very much, sir, for this kindness. I deeply appreciate Mr. Honeycutt arranging my brief visit with you this morning. And I appreciate the work that you, the chairman, and your colleagues do for our county. Late last night, I returned home from the annual reunion of the 446 Bomb Group Association meeting at Dayton, Ohio for the past 4 days. Now, this World War II bomb group, with whom my older brother served many years ago and was killed on a bombing raid in southern France, opened its membership some years ago to family members and friends. 18 years ago, when my wife and I were privileged to join this bomb group association, there would be between 100 and maybe 175 veterans who served in that group during World War II, 150 or more. This past week, there were only three veterans from that group able to attend. Thus, I'm deeply appreciative for your consideration in giving a special tribute to the World War II men and women who attend this event on July the 3rd. It's called a Salute to Hometown Heroes and Beyond. It will be conducted at the Williams High School at 3:00 on July the 3rd. It's countywide and beyond. We're trying to let our veterans who are still with us know that we appreciate them and support them. We will have a concert band that will do approximately 20 minutes of patriotic music prior to the program. And at 3:00, we have two ladies who go all over the United States doing programs for veterans and for the public. They are indeed dynamic, to say the least. They are called the Letters from Home, and they are based in Winston-Salem. However, the headquarters is in Chicago. And they will be here to help us with that event. It's free. Everyone is invited to come, not only veterans, but their families and all of their friends that possibly can be there. We are asking individuals to bring canned goods to help feed the needy, and two of our organizations in the county will be there to accept the food. But we do appreciate very much whatever resolution or however you word it that we can provide these World War II men on that day. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Thank you for what you've done there. That's very, very good. We appreciate it. All right. With that, now we will ask for approval of our agenda for today.
I so move that we approve the agenda.
Okay. Thank you, Bob. Second. Yep. Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, our consent agenda for today, is there anything on that we would need to pull out or recognize?
I move we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Roger. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Next up, we will have Board of Equalization and Review to come and make us a presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, fellow commissioners, staff, and citizens. This is probably a very unusual occurrence. 8 years ago, all of you remember that we had a reevaluation in the county. I'd like to forget that, but unfortunately, that was the year that I became the chairman of the Equalization and Review Board. Old plowboy from out in the country coming here to preside over the Equalization Review Board. After the first year, I thought to myself, what have I got myself into? To give you what I want to do this morning is carry you back to the past and bring you up to the future as to the accomplishments that have been done in the 8 years that we've had serving on that board. First of all, we have two of that's on the Equalization Review Board, Ms. Beth Glidewell and Rhett Davis. The other person will be Amy Scoggins and will be Mickey Tripp. We have three people on the board that are involved in real estate. Red and I have an agricultural background. I don't have to tell you what his background is because he served as the county director for several years. And we appreciate his service. I don't know where the citizens of this county realize the importance and the power, that may not be a good word, but the Equalization Review Board has. No taxes, no tax base is reduced in the county unless it's approved by the Board of Equalization and signed off by the chairman. Back in 2009, I want to bring you back some and review with you. In 2009, we had 18,892 complaints or appeals. We had to have some help from a neighboring supervisor, retired from Wake County, to help us through this evaluation. Out of that 18,902 complaints, the Board of Equalization approved $399 million for the tax base to be reduced. That's astronomical. We had no choice. We knew that we did not have a good evaluation. We recognized that, and measures were taken at that time to correct that. Out of that, in 2009, we had $2,076,000 reduction in revenue for the county. I want everybody here to realize that the tax department is the engine that pulls a train. Let that sink in. That is the engine that drives, that pulls a train. Without revenue, you can't do your job and we can't get anything done in the county. It's very important that we pay attention and that we do the things that's necessary to get the job done. Well, after I spent that year on the board, and believe me, the Board of Equalization typically meets just in April, and we're finished. We went through July. I thought we would never do it. These were legitimate complaints, folks. These are complaints that we paid $1,600,000 for an outsider to come and screw up, pardon my French. That's what we were faced with. Now, after that year, I'm the type of person that if I'm appointed to anything, I'm going to get involved. I got involved. There's two things I wanted to know. We knew that we had a problem with revaluation. We knew that. But it went deeper than that. Why were we still having problems? I met with the people in the tax department. Gerald York was one of them. And talked with those people there to find out what our problem was. And what I found out, and there's people in here who will contest to that fact, we were not communicating. The left hand didn't know what the right hand was doing. I made a list and sat down with Mr. Honeycutt. You see, I'm an outsider. I'm a taxpayer just like you. I ain't on the payroll. But I'm concerned that the things that we were doing was not in order. The basic problem, as I said, was communication. He and I sat down and we discussed those problems. I appreciate you listening. I also recognize that he had a board of commissioners that had to initiate or approve what was we wanted to do. The first thing that we agreed upon in the tax department and with these people that we needed an in-house evaluation. We don't need outsiders coming in and telling us what the value of our property is. So, in order to do that, we had to hire people. We were already short in the tax department. We had to hire people, not bodies, but people that were capable of coming in our county, that lived in our county, and knew the value of your property and my property, and documented that. We set out to get that done. We knew that in 2017, we had to have a new evaluation done. But we had a problem, immediate problem, that needed to be corrected then. And that was present use value. I had to go to several locations to get people that was in the know to understand what present use value is and was. That's the program that farmers that produce crops and all, they have a reduced rate per acre so that they will afford them an opportunity to farm. We got that communications taken care of. We hired one person to administer the present use value program. Heretofore, we had not policed that program in the county, and the statute says that we must audit these every 8 years. That was not done. And I can attest to the fact, because I own property in other counties, they're not even doing it now. But that's a statute that we have to live by. So we set out and we hired a present use value person. All of you, if you're in business or have been in business, you understand one thing is ROI, return on investment. This organization should be no different from your business and my business. We have got to get a return on our investment of time and money. I want to share with you some figures this morning that supports that thought. Since 2009, we have taken, the tax department has taken out of present use value. I ain't talking about farms now, but I'm talking about parcels. And there's 70,000 parcels in this county. They have taken out of the program because of lack of compliance. 338 parcels. I want to tell you, the first year we took them out, we lost money. But as of this year, that program has paid for its cost. We have hired two people, we've had two vehicles. And y'all know what the salaries, the basic salaries of those people are at the present times. The cost of implementing that program is about $440,000. I want to say this morning that that program has been turned around. We have took 338 people off parcels out of that, and we've got a net profit this morning of $730,548. That's what I call return on investment. That's important. Number two, I want you to know that we needed people. To date, there have been 7 people added to the tax department. Not bodies, but people that have been trained to be professionals. The problem that we had before is that we didn't have people that were capable of talking to a taxpayer and giving him the right answers. because we weren't trained. There's a difference. We need people, and I want to emphasize this, and I'll shut up in just a minute. That I like to emphasize that the tax department is not a law enforcement. They don't work for you. We are servants, and we are responsible for answering the questions and appeasing the customer who has a problem, and it's important for us to listen to it. All of our people in the tax department have been trained to that. An ongoing training program is constantly in that program. We have added, as I said, 7 people to that organization. I can share with you this morning that the reval, which is responsible for being published in 2017, is ready. All the 70,000 parcels in the county have been visited. Ain't none of this drive-by shade tree stuff that's gone on in the past. All of that's been eliminated. And that was our intent to start with. We've got people that have visited those and come back with their evaluation of these particular parcels. And to date, as it appears right now, all of that is completed. The computations is in the process of being, and in talking to Mr. Akins, it appears right now that we're going to save $700,000 less than we paid for some outside source to come in and give us an evaluation. Folks, that's an accomplishment. Not only we got people that has come up with those figures and they're working constantly, we have got a tax staff today that is competent, that is getting the job done, and it's done in-house. They're one of us. They're taxpayers just like you and I. My real purpose for being here this morning, this could have never happened unless I had meetings with the chair and the vice chair outside of these buildings many times and they bought on to the program and what we were trying to do. I want to say thank you for listening. Thank you for you and some of you were not here, but for listening and acting. It was a good thing for the county, and it's going to be proved to even better. We lost our tax base in 2009 was $12.4 billion. We took $400 million out of that. Today, our tax base is back to $12.9 billion, and collections for the last 3 years has been up. I want to thank you for listening and for acting. Folks, we've got to get involved. I'm going to make one final statement. As you approach the budget, my recommendation to you is this. Let's satisfy our needs and forget about our wants. And pass a budget that is based on those facts. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Frank. And actually, our next honor thing is the recognition of the Citizen Volunteer of the Year. And I think there's a couple folks outside that didn't get in earlier. If you guys don't mind coming in. Sorry, everybody was crowded out today. We'll come down here to the podium and make this presentation.
Frank, you look a little.
Frank, you look confused.
You look confused. He's looking confused. See?
I didn't know all this was happening.
We let you talk and you did a good job, but now see what happens when you talk too long? They all just show up. Mr. Frank Bale. born and raised in Alabama and moved to North Carolina in 1960. He's been married to his lovely wife, Julia, over here. And they've been married for 55 years. They have two children, Natalie and Scott, four grandchildren, right? Got a fine looking family there. Family and church are the highest priority to Frank. This is demonstrated by his years of coaching Little League sports teams, serving as the chairperson for many committees at Bethlehem Christian Church, Lakeview Community Church, and currently at St. Luke's United Methodist. In addition to the committees at St. Luke's, Frank is a well-respected Sunday school teacher and choir member. Frank has led a life of service to the community in numerous ways. He's worked diligently over the last 8 years as chairman of the Board of Equalization and Review. At these meetings, he's demonstrated an eagerness to hear and address the concerns of the citizens of Alamance County. Being a cattleman at heart, Frank has been active with Alamance County Cattlemen's Association and Scimitar Association, serving as president for both organizations. The Scimitar Association presented Frank with their highest honor in 2012, making him the first cattleman in North Carolina to ever receive it. So you're setting records in too, right? As a proven friend to agriculture, Frank has worked tirelessly to promote conservation through his role with Farm Bureau and the Jordan Lake Water Rules Committee. In 2011, the Alamance County Cooperative Extension Service presented him with the Service to Agriculture Award. Frank Bell has shown that he has a love for our community and demonstrates this each day through his willingness to mentor to individuals and leaders alike. He has worked to promote innovation and excellence in our county government as well as Alamance County as a whole. And I think we can all witness that by his presentation today. Frank has a great heart for our community. He's been a great leader to me in helping work through these issues with our tax board and figuring out how to do things better in Alamance County. Frank, if you and your family would like to come up and get you some pictures here, and just want to present this to you and thank you so much.
This is definitely a surprise. I've never seen you speak.
Thank y'all for coming. Thank you, Frank, for what you've done. Anybody like to make any comments? Let him hug you, sweet. Good to see you.
I just like to say, I remember that ride we took in your car, Frank, up to the northern part of the county. I learned more on that ride than I did in that sort of a period of time in probably forever. That was great. Thank you.
All right. Very good. Thank you. All right. Next on our list is the Workforce Development Annual Report. James Bain, I guess. James is the Assistant Director of the Regional Partnership for Workforce Development, and Lisa Arnett is Director of Alamance County North Carolina Works Career Center. Thank y'all for coming today.
Thank you for having us. I just want to let you know this is not Lisa Arnett. This is Tammy Wall. She's the co-director
of
the Alamance County Center.
Okay.
If I could, I'd like to give you all
some big great.
Thank you.
I'm going to briefly go over our annual report. However, as I've done this presentation in the past, the county commissioners from various counties that we serve have asked us, what are you doing for our county? This is a beautiful report, but let us know what you're doing for our county and our citizens. And that's what this paper is right here.
Okay.
But first of all, just going over our annual report, There's a message from the board chair here that talks about the transition from Workforce Investment Act services over to Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Services, which is basically more employer-oriented. There's a lot more work-based learning. There's an integration of services between our training services and what used to be the old Employment Security Commission, which is now DWS, Division of Workforce Solutions. Right here is our workforce board members and the different counties that they represent, our youth council members, and then beginning on page 8, our individual counties, the services that we provide. There's some success stories and just some things that are going on in the various centers. In the very middle of the book is our budget. Our total budget for 2014-15 was $3,522,933. Of that, Alamance County got $733,150. We sent 164 people to college with that money. We sent them to a vocational school. We sent them to a two-year degree or four-year degree programs if they were already a junior. In addition, we sent them to work-based learning. We put them to work after they got their degrees. And there's some very good stories. I would welcome you to read through the different stories, especially Alamance County. On page 20 and 21, please pay attention to the customer testimonials. There's two very good testimonials that take about 5 minutes for you to read, tell you exactly what kind of services we're providing and the customer satisfaction rate. But I definitely want to get into what we're doing for Alamance County and the services we're providing. That's why I have Tammy here. Basically, as a job seeker, you have all the tools you need at the Alamance County Center in Burlington. The service that we provide at no charge to the consumer is career assessment and guidance, access to training and educational programs, job fairs, workshops, information on the job market, assistance with searching for jobs, resume, cover letter preparation, practice for interviewing jobs, free computer and internet access, and help registering in the NC Works database system. So far this year, up until June the 3rd, we've served a total of 5,754 individual customers in Alamance County, 376 which are veterans. We have registered 1,281 new individual customers, 49 of which were veterans. The services that we offer to Alamance County businesses at no charge is job applicant screening, qualified candidate referrals, valuable up-to-date labor market facts and projections such as wages, information on tax credits for hiring particular groups of workers, space to conduct job interviews, help arranging job fairs, workshops for employee-related subjects, reference library, employee training resources, layoff and closure prevention services, and information on federal bonding. We also offer direct training services to employers. Employers can train employees through different programs that are designed to improve the skills of workers. On-the-job training programs help employers to train individuals for a position. This program, we reimburse 50% of the participant's salary for the first 500 or so hours while they're learning those skills on the job, you know, to help out the employer for the cost of their training. We have an NC Works apprenticeship program. We have NC Works incumbent worker program, which is specifically designed to train employees that are already at the center that are at the job that need additional skills. We offer job profiling and work keys, which is really becoming an important thing where we go in to a particular business and the business comes to us and says, just for instance, you know, we need a director for a particular department. You know, we go in, profile the job, look at the job description, offer work keys, assessment, testing, and training directly for that job. So far this year, we've provided a total of 12,311 services to local employers. We've assisted employers create 1,921 job orders. Moving on to Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. Just to give you an idea of what it is, if you don't know, there's two separate funding streams from the federal government, specifically for scholarships for individuals. FAFSA, which is a Pell Grant, and WIOA Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act is the second. Regional Partnership Workforce Development Board serves five counties. We serve Alamance, Montgomery, Moore, Orange, and Randolph County. WIOA empowers North Carolina to train its workforce and guides how the NC Works initiative connects job seekers and employers. WIOA provides access to high-quality training. It helps job seekers acquire industry-recognized credentials for in-demand jobs. Training that leads to industry-recognized post-secondary credentials is emphasized. We use career pathways to provide education, employment, and training assistance to accelerate job seekers' educational and career advancement. And customers are provided with NC Works approved training provider choices. We don't say Alamance Community College is offering business administration. We have several community colleges offer it, and we let them make the choice, you know, as if it is approved by Raleigh in our system. We improve services offered to employees, including work-based training programs, which we talked briefly about before, on-the-job training. We have specifically for in-demand jobs. If you want to come in and train for something crazy, I can't think of anything off the top of my head, we don't really just approve anything. They have to be in-demand jobs. They have to have at least a 2% growth rate forecasted in the next 4 years, or we can't pay for it. I have some demographic information on the next few pages for you to look at. The first one is our training activities expenditures. 52% of our training monies are spent on occupational skills training, ITAs. What an ITA is, an individual training account. Basically, that is college education, getting a degree, getting some kind of training that ends in a degree. 36% of our training is non-ITA, which is short-term training such as CNA, CDL, things of that nature. And then 12% is on-the-job training, where we work with employers, you know, to do training on the job. Here's some of the ages of the customers that we serve. Beginning employment status of the consumer served in Alamance County, you can see 77% of the customers we serve are unemployed when they come into our office. Beginning education levels of some of the clients that we serve. Then moving on to employer services in Alamance County, there's a good chart on that that shows the particular type of registered employer. The typical employer served in Alamance County is from the private sector with between 1 and 99 employees, although we do serve several large employers with hundreds of employees. Please refer to the following industry sector chart for the guidance of the wide variety of employer industries we serve in Alamance County. If you look over here on this chart, you can see we serve a lot of different type of employees, from accommodation and food services, waste management, agriculture, forestry, construction, educational services, healthcare services, management companies, manufacturing, transportation, real estate, retail traders, wide variety of employers we serve. On the next page, you can see the top actual employers that we work with: Cone Health, Alamance Burlington Schools, Donnelly and Sons, Laboratory Corporation of America, Food Line, Lowe's Foods, PSA Healthcare, Petra Shopping Centers, Pizza Hut, and more. Below it, you can see the average hourly wage for Alamance County citizen compared to North Carolina. The average wage for Alamance County citizen is $19.03 as compared to a $23.45 statewide. We're trying really hard with training to bring Alamance County wages up to at least the state level. And finally, I do want to show you an article that appeared from the Times News Burlington newspaper on May the 16th of this year. And if you let me, I'll be glad to read it for you. It says, NC Works Center makes a difference. I would like to bring to the community's attention the extremely valuable resource that exists at the Employment Security Commission, or NC Works Career Center, located on Columbine Lane in Burlington. I was laid off from my job on April 21st of this year. Although my job loss was anticipated, it happened much sooner than expected, and I was not prepared to be without income and sense of purpose my job provided. When I tearfully entered the NC Works Career Center on the morning of April 22nd, I was feeling deflated, panicked, and desperate. The people at the NC Works Career Center immediately made me aware of several positions for which I'm qualified, wisely encouraged me to keep my job search targeted so that I would be challenged and happy in my next position, and signed me up for free classes to improve my computer skills and job-seeking skills. By 24 hours post-job loss, I was feeling hopeful and marketable once again. Within my first week, I had landed 4 successful interviews, and I'm happy to report I started a new position on May the 11th. The NC Works Career Center provides free, unlimited computer use, free use of printers, fax machine, and resume advice and preparation. In addition, they provide information on educational and community resources. There's always someone available to give interviewing tips. I went there every single day to use their computer, look for jobs, get advice, and socialize. With each interview request I received, the people at the NC Works Career Center were as excited as I was. Their enthusiasm and faith in me helped to keep my spirits uplifted with what would otherwise have been an extremely challenging time. Anyone who finds himself seeking new or first-time employment should be aware of this outstanding community resource and the helpful, enthusiastic, compassionate individuals that work there. And I have one of those individuals here, one of the co-directors of the center, and I would like to have her to say a couple things.
Well, I think James covered most everything. He took the words out of my mouth. My name is Tammy Wall, and I am the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act Director in our Alamance County Career Center. Unfortunately, to let the public know, we are not the unemployment office. As far as I know, we've never officially been the unemployment office. That's just the name the public gave, because that's typically where you go when you are unemployed. But we are now the NC Works Career Center, and we are very happy with that new title. There's been some changes in workforce development, and our center is now a model of the integrated service delivery, and we are certified with that status as a level one center, and we recently received our continuation of our certification for another 6 months, while I think some new stuff is going on in the works, and there may be some new criteria and benchmarks that we'll need to meet to maintain our certification, but we feel confident that we'll be able to do that. So with some of that being said about the unemployment office, this isn't your parents' unemployment office. This is a new center with new customer service tactics. We strive to meet that customer at the door and have them go through a flow of integrated services where they can go meet our welcome team, and they will assess them, and then they can send them to the talent development section, which would be our WIO training services, or directly to employment services if they're ready to enter the job market right away, such as the lady mentioned in the article. We also have the employer service team that works directly with the employers. I think Mr. Bain highlighted the fact that we do a lot more work now than in the past directly with the employers. We do have weekly somewhere between 4 to 8 employers in our center doing on-site interviews every week in our office. We have great partnership in the community. Well, we have a very strong partnership with Alamance Community College, our Vocational Rehabilitation Center, our Department of Social Services, the Community Services Agency, which does the Community Service Block Grant, Burlington Housing Authority, the Senior Age Program, the Burlington School System, the Chamber of Commerce, and the Alamance County Human Resource Association. We have representation and partnerships with all of those organizations, and as a result, it allows us to provide better services not only to our job seekers but to our employers in the community as well. We have on-site partners. The Alamance Community College has a staff person in our office approximately 15 hours a week. We have a one of their employees works there to screen our customers for short-term training and the free classes that the lady, again, mentioned in the article. Free computer classes for both beginner and intermediate computer classes, those services are free. We have a lot of people that may have worked in a particular industry for a long period of time, and they may not have, you know, very good computer skills, and now they do need that that skill so that they can effectively job seek and hopefully secure employment sooner rather than later. We have the Educational Opportunity Center in our office weekly who help screen people for the FAFSA, the Pell Grant that Mr. Bain mentioned, vocational rehab to work with our customers with disabilities, and our North Carolina Black Aged Association who works with our seniors who are job seeking as well. We have a new company. They officially opened in January of 15. It's Cambro Manufacturing. They're out of California. We have done a total of 15 on-the-job trainings with them. We have one that just started, which makes the 16th, and we're working on another one right now. We have one with a Orange County company, Summit Design and Engineering, but the customer is an Alamance County resident. And we also have served six customers with an on-the-job training with International Textile Group here in Burlington. We have in our training program for people who are in classes, we have served 132 this particular year. We have 38 completers right now. Of those, 70% of those are currently employed, and we still have until June 30th to get the rest of them employed. We have an additional 17 that will be exiting our program at the end of the year, and all of them have a job offer at this time. We have placed people in jobs during this fiscal year for us in trucking, EMT, paramedic, fire academy, medical assisting, welding, HVAC, and computer integrated machining. And most all of our customers are making above the normal standard of living that would enable them to be self-sufficient on their wages. So we're very proud of that fact as well. I think that's about all I have to say.
I just want to say Alamance County Center is a leader in our local area, and it's a leader in the state. It was one of the very first centers to integrate with Employment Security Commission. Number six in the state.
Where is your center located?
It's behind the cutting board.
Okay.
I encourage everyone to come visit our center just to take a tour. Our website is www.ncworks.gov. The homepage before you ever log in or register has a wealth of resources available to a job seeker. You can create yourself a profile. If you do so, do it as an individual, and you can go on and play with the system and see the jobs that are available. There are online assessments to help you determine job exploration, career exploration, what you might be best suited to, and there is a way for you to create a resume on that site as well, which employers can view as well.
Thank you very much.
Got a quick question. What's your staff headcount doing all this support? Sound like a lot of work.
We have three staff who are paid by the Workforce and Innovation Act, and then we have, I have to do a head count. We have two veteran services. We have 1, 2, 8, I think you're right, 8 that are state employees by the Department of Commerce. And of course, we're integrated, although we all get paid by someone different, but there's approximately 12 of us in that office that serves our customers. And we're integrated, so everybody can serve anybody.
Very good. Thank you all very much for the update.
Thank you.
All right, next we have Brian Baker with Parks and Rec to come and accept grant from Impact Alamance. Hey, Brian.
I come before you today to request permission to accept a grant from Impact Alamance to develop a playground on Saxapaha Island. The grant is for $100,000. I've been up here a few times with Impact Alamance grants. They've been very generous to us in achieving their goals of a healthier, wellness-based community. And they've offered us $100,000 to help us develop a playground on Saxapaha Island.
So moved.
No No match.
I'll second it. But I have a question.
Yes.
How does one get to the island? Is it by boat or is there, can you walk?
Yeah, you can drive to it.
You can drive to it?
There'll be a parking area there on the island.
All right, we have a motion and a second, so I guess we'll just vote on it. Is that okay, Dave?
Yes, sir.
All right. All in favor? Aye. No opposition? Thank you. Thank you, Brian. I know that was brief. Thanks. All right.
I guess this is what everybody's been waiting for.
This is the man we need to hear from right here.
Reading the lights going out.
Yeah. So we have to try to get out of here.
Before we start, I do want to thank Frank Bell as well for the work that he's done. And Frank really opened up a lot of communication between, I think, the manager's department and also the tax department. And I also want to thank the work that Jeremy Aikens has done. And with the entire tax department, the collections, through the assessor's department, a lot of that, Jeremy and I, we listen to Frank. And 99.9% of the time, Frank is right. And so we appreciate Frank's commitment to the county and very, very well deserved. So we did thank Frank. First, let me start off by saying is, as I told the judge a little bit earlier today, this is the day probably as a county manager that is, you know, of the 364 days are great. This day is one where everybody's mad. So if you're mad a little bit, everybody's mad a little bit, then it may be not a bad budget. So that's what we're hoping for. One of the things I think we have to remember is last year we took some major steps in dealing with a lot of different issues. If the board remembers, and I'm sure you won't forget, we had a 5-cent tax increase last year.
I remember.
You do remember? It was a... seems like just yesterday.
They reminded quite often.
But we had some major issues that we had to deal with. Number one was capital. Number two was our employee paying classification plan. And number three was the school system. So we took some major steps last year. This year we're still taking steps, but they're not as major as they were last year. We're still moving forward. We have a lot of issues that we're still moving forward on, from technology, employee health care fund. You know, if you remember, we got dinged on that by the local government commission, that our fund balance was low, so we're trying to address that. We're trying to update technology this year with our finance software and our time-keeping software. Looking at new debt service with the community college, and also we're starting to put money aside for the animal shelter. So we're still moving forward, but maybe not in as major steps as some would hope. But I think we've tried to address in this budget a lot of different things, still moving the county forward in a positive direction. So let's start. Total budget. $162,274,533. The biggest one for the board to look at is really our general fund at $141.6 million. The rest are kind of designated funds, employee insurance, workers' comp, property insurance, fire districts, reserve, and our telephone fund. So what does that $141 million mean? As far as the tax rate, it means that, well, first, we had requests of about $149 million. Even at $141 million, we had to cut over $7.5 million to the original request from the departments and the outside agencies. So, the recommendation of this budget is a 58-cent tax rate, which means no tax increase recommended this year. And again, 1 cent equals about $1.265 million, and that's kind of been sort of average over the last 3 or 4 years. And please stop me at any time if you have any questions. We're seeing higher revenue, especially in sales tax. We're seeing valuation growing some, 1.9%. Sales tax revenue is higher. And also miscellaneous taxes and fees have increased. Inspection fees have gone up. Our ambulance fees have gone up some. So we're seeing an increase in normal growth on our fees. So our total revenue increase is $2 million. We're recommending to use fund balance. And again, it's more fund balance than we have used in the past. This year we're projecting to use $5.2 million in fund balance and assigned fund balance of $643,000. And what that is, we have set money aside in the revalve fund that was in a designated fund. We're moving over to operating now. And also, if you do remember, we're responsible for the LME's retirees, the 93 employees that were, or 98 employees that were retired at the time of merger. So we're still picking up their cost with their fund balance. So that's, I think that's about $400,000 in it. So that's where that $643,000 comes from. Just in the FYI, we were planning to use just $5 million in fund balance as of Friday, but Friday at 11 a.m., we got notification from the state of North Carolina that the employer's retirement percentage was going up, and that was an additional cost of $235,000. So that's where that $5.2 million comes from. So that was something we found out on Friday. Again, we focused on this year county service delivery, support for education, and debt service. Again, we got new debt that is coming towards us. We needed to look at personnel. And one of the commitments that we tried to move forward on was our paid class study. And one of the things we tried to do originally was to put a full step in with respect to those employees under the median. Those employees that were under market, we wanted to go a full step. Well, funding was not available for that. So what we're recommending this year is a COLA, a cost of living increase for all employees of 1.5% across the board. And however, if you were under the market rate, you would get an additional 1.5%. So for about 156 employees who are at market or above, they would get 1.5%. For the 800 employees that we have that are below market, they would get an additional 1.5%. But again, we are looking at some new positions. Career ladders, there's a lot that we did not have career ladders for, especially in CCOM, and we did a couple reclassifications as well. And again, that mandatory state retirement employer match, we found out on June 3rd. But again, we also wanted to look at infrastructure. And one of the things that we've already made the commitment to is our technology. And our especially our software for finance. And that we have in there, but we also need to look at MIS and some security issues. You remember we had a crash, and so we're trying to take steps to make sure that crash is not averted or is averted in the future. But we have capital outlay, 1.2. Our capital improvement plan is really our large maintenance items for our over 500 square feet of county floor space. And again, we have maintenance costs for aging infrastructure and animal shelter. That's not a full year, that's a partial year of an additional 125 for new construction.
Before that, COLA, can you explain that again to me? What's the difference in the 1.5% and the 3% increase?
So,
and how much cash money is that?
1.17. Is total.
That's it right up there.
Yes, sir.
Line two.
I can't read.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry, Judge. It's 1.1. $7 million is the increase in cost of living.
$1.1 million.
Yes, sir. And also,
is that for the total?
Yes, sir. Also, what we
800 employees and the 89 or 90.
What we did on our paying class is number one, we have about 980 full time equivalent employees.
Right.
So everybody gets a 1.5% increase.
And that's what, 1.1 million.
Well, that's part of it, yes, sir. And then we have eight, you know, our paying class study, and we were trying to move people towards market. If you were below market, which is 800 of our employees,
oh, okay,
we'd get an additional 1.5%.
And the total cost is 1.1 million.
Yes, sir.
For all of it. Okay, that's what
I'm almost 1.2.
Yes, sir.
1.17.
I got you.
But again, 180 would only get 1.5%. So again, if you're not at market, and also one of the things we would do with the cost of living, we're looking at upgrading our paying class and moving them the ranges up by 1.5% to kind of keep us competitive, especially with entry level salaries. Now that was part of our problem in the past was we did not move our salary ranges when we did cost of living, and then if you wait for 10 years, that's when it gets so low. Again, outside agency, education, additional funds for ABSS and ACC operations, and new debt service for the tech center. Other outside agencies, were basically flat. One of the things that I know the board, I sent you an email about a couple of weeks ago, we're starting to get a lot of requests from outside agencies on wanting funding from the county. You know, recently we've had Allied Churches, we've had Partnership for Children. So one of the things that I would recommend to the board is that we relook at how we fund outside agencies and who we fund, and making sure that they're meeting the goals and objectives and mission of the county. So we did not include any additional outside agencies at this point. However, we will relook at that in the fall if the board is willing to do that, and see, you know, who we should be funding, who we should not be funding, and at what levels. So so we would do that. And again, Judge, I don't know if you did that when you did outside agencies, just kind of historical, the way outside agencies have been. So we wanted to look at it. Are we making sure we're funding those that are meeting our needs?
What was the debt service for the new tech center? What was the dollar amount of that?
$306,000.
Yes, I've got another slide. Yes, sir.
Oh.
Again, operating budget trends, technology. Again, new hardware, new software. We kind of got behind on some things. The need requests, budget requests, within each department and MIS. We also want to look at a technology improvement plan. We're hoping that that'll be able to save us a lot on additional personnel in the future. And again, if we really look at it, our service delivery, if you look at their operating budgets, 15 out of 32 departments, their calls were either kept unchanged from 15-16. So, you know, even though there are increases and some are with respect to personnel costs, there's a lot of operating costs that were still kept flat. And again, this is the new debt service, ACC at 306, 250, our animal shelter at 125, and total new debt service of 431,000. But again, ACC, that's only interest payment. Next year, you're probably looking at $1.1 million, $1.2 million, because interest and principal.
That will be another penny on tax rate, basically, at that point in time.
So.
Well, unless we get increased revenue somewhere else.
Yeah.
Decreased
sales tax.
Other line items.
Is our total debt somewhere around $70 million now?
Our total debt right now at the end of this year will be $42 million. Once we add the 15 for the 10,
that's right.
We'll be back up to 10.
We wrote off some this year,
yes,
didn't
sir.
We?
Yes, yes, sir. We looked at new positions. In general government, we looked at one, and that was in our MIS department. This is a position that we need with respect to security for HIPAA issues. It's an issue for health department. It's an issue for social services. We don't have a HIPAA compliance officer over technology, and we do need somebody that we can look at who's responsible. In human services, there's five positions, four in DSS, and one that is a former half-time position moved to full-time as a health clerk or in environmental health. Also, those DSS positions are partially funded and reimbursed. A couple are 50%, I think one 75%.
And it's on the additional
slide. Oh, it's on the additional slide. Landfill is two positions, and one thing we realized with Greg Thomas leaving us, we didn't have an assistant director down there, and we need to get a good assistant director so we can able to have somebody step in case there's issues with our director. I do want to say Richard Hill is down there now in an interim basis, and Richard is doing a fabulous job on that.
Great.
Of course, this doesn't even affect our budget, though.
No, sir.
Not the landfill.
That was my question.
Yeah. The landfill positions, again, are enterprise funds. We made about $800,000 on tipping fees and all that capital. Most of that money goes into a post-closure account. But again, career ladder for EMS, CCOM, and health. EMS, we had some positions we were not paying for. We were not encouraging our employees to get higher certifications. Also, same thing with CCOM. We wanted to give them a reason to stay and give them goals to shoot for so that we could be as professional departments that we can be. Same thing in health. We had career ladders in the Sheriff's Department. We have career ladders in DSS. But we do not have those in these three departments. And also, we're looking at six position reclassifications. Four of those are in EMS. We have had assistant crew chiefs forever, and we have not paid them for being assistant crew chiefs. So we were going to give a little pay differential to be an assistant crew chief. Again, this is more in detail. Our compliance officer in MIS, CGIS, public safety, PCI for finance, public privacy law. Right now, we do not have anybody that is certified with respect to those type of controls, excuse me, with respect to security. And especially HIPAA is a big issue. And we're at the point that this will be a great benefit for all departments. Again, environmental health. That used to be a shared position between inspections and environmental health. So half-time in inspections and half-time in environmental health. Well, inspections, as busy as they've been, they have kind of taken over that position full-time. And so we were going to increase that staffing for excuse me, environmental health. Social services, three income maintenance workers, two reimbursement at 75%, one at 50, and then one is a social worker three, which is a 50% reimbursement. Sheriff, public safety, two deputy one positions. And we've had conversations with the sheriff about this, as he originally asked for five. What we have kind of worked on with the sheriff is once he does get full staffed, that we would then look again at the other two positions, and that may be a mid-year issue that we do. And we've had some lap salary that we are using some of his lap salary this year on some capital as well. But once we get full staff, then we will come back to the board for the additional positions. Also, fire marshal, there was a request for a full-time, but this position will be a part-time, basically to help with our on-call issues on the weekends. And then in EMS, one is an operations officer. If the board remembers, we had some issues with EMS billing. And we did not have, we have outsourced our billing, and we did not have a local contact within our department that could handle those type of issues, especially with our back bills and dealing with debt set off. We needed to have a face here locally. Also, we served the operations and helped with scheduling, those type of issues as well. Again, there's a reclass of positions, EMT to assistant crew chief, and also we're going to give our training officers some additional responsibilities, so we're asking for that pay to be reclassed as well. Capital needs, vehicles, $591,000. The sheriff's department, we have 12 new patrol vehicles. Emergency management, everybody knows Debbie, her first week here, we've had her truck more in the shop than we have her driving it. So we need one for her. And also EMS, we're looking at two remounts. So they're about $90,000 a piece for the remounts. Again, equipment, miscellaneous, MIS, got a lot of infrastructure for technology. Also, our heart monitors and power stretchers. Our heart monitors are 24. They are getting out of certification. So we're going to do this over a four-year period that we will replace our heart monitors and also our power stretchers. We need to really look at including all of our fleet with the power stretchers because our they help with workers' comp issues, trying to lift the patient into the back of the truck. So that's a need for the power stretchers. Again, other improvements, this safe security fencing and restroom improvements, library materials, 206. And then $250,000 for our CIP. And these are just some of the projects that we are looking at doing with our CIP. Again, school system. Their request was $40.2 million. Current expense was at $39.7 million, and capital outlay was $500,000. Managers recommended is about a $1.3 million increase. Again, not everything that the school system asks for probably needs, but again, trying to address their concerns also with the concerns of all departments and also trying to make sure we keep our tax rate at 58 cents. The community college requested over $5 million. Their current expense actually decreased. The big increase that they had was for capital outlay. We're recommending that they be increased $60,000 because their current expense went down. The reason why we're recommending only $60,000 is with the bond money that they have recently received, $6.2 million, that they will have some money to do some of the repairs that I think that they were trying to do as part of that $2 million increase. Again, just a quick chart. Education is about 29% of what we do. Culture and recreation is 3.8%. Others, almost 7. General fund at 10.5. Public safety at 23.5. Environmental protection is 0.5%. Transportation is at 0.12, and that's ACTA. Economic and physical development is almost at 1%. And then human services at 25.78. We also have had three fire departments that have requested a tax increase. So they will be here at our public hearing as well on the 20th. If you have any specific questions of them, Fawcett is asking for a 1.75 cent increase, Northeast 2 cents, and North Central 1 cent. And with that said, we have a public hearing that we would like for you to call for June 20th at 7 p.m. And I think we have discussed the historic courthouse at this time. Let me say, this is, I appreciate the work, especially Susan and Andrea and our department heads have done, and also the board to get us to this point. We had 5 days of fun. Hearing presentations from all our departments and our outside agencies. But I think it's an important process for us to go through so that you can hear exactly from the horse's mouth and maybe not the horse's behind on that, what their truly, their issues are and what their wants and needs are. Again, this is a recommended budget. I want to be as clear as a bell. This is a manager's recommended budget. This is my responsibility to do under North Carolina General Statute. Now, I wish I could quote the statute number. But once it's recommended, it is your budget. And we can make changes. We can make whatever you so choose. And if we do need to have additional workshops, we can do that as well. Before the budget public hearing on the 20th, we are at your will. So you tell us what you want, and we'll be glad to try to address it.
I got one question on the use of undesignated fund balance last year. Where are we in relation to what we're using of that?
We shouldn't use any this year.
So we'd set aside, what,
3.5,
and we really aren't going to use
that. We're not going to use it. We'll probably add this year. I think we're looking at maybe $2 million.
Two to three
that we will add. It's very early, but we don't feel like we'll be using any this year.
So it's possible for next year's budget, with what you have budgeted to use out of fund balance, that we may not
touch.
If history is representative, we wouldn't be using any of that.
It's kind of a common practice just to use fund balance. And there were a couple of years we didn't use fund balance to balance.
When you say use, you mean budgeted?
Budget. Yes, sir. It's kind of common practice.
Because we didn't really use it.
We didn't. Just kind of bridge the gap. There were a couple of years, especially during the recession, we didn't budget any fund balance. Again, that got, we cut to the bone. And you know, that's when we didn't have any capital or any increases or any new employees, and we were cutting schools, and we were.
And our fund balance was marginal.
And our fund balance was very marginal.
So really, it's like a placeholder. And then, should we get additional revenues or whatever, we use less of that budgeted fund balance.
Yes, sir. It is. You know, worst case scenario on the 5.2. is if revenues only come in what we say and expenditures are expended at 100%, we have to use the 5.2. But usually we spend less than what we budget, and usually get more revenue in what we budget as well. So it does kind of wash sometimes.
There's only one other thing. I noticed the fire department's asking for some increases.
Yes,
I know,
sir.
We talked about that a couple years or one time, that when they did bring those, that they would actually bring us a kind of a, why do they need it? What are their
right
expenditures they're looking to do?
And they will do that at budget public hearing.
Okay, so
they'll make a presentation.
Okay, very good.
Yes, sir.
Can we get a hard copy of your pitch?
Yes. Yes, sir.
That'd be good, and make some
be glad to
notes
on
that.
Yeah,
I agree. I was going to ask that, too.
Yeah.
That's very good.
Judge,
thank you.
Appreciate
that.
It helps to point the changes that we'd have to figure that out on our own if we went through this.
Yeah. Well, and again, you know, we've got, if the changes need to be made, we've got time. And we'll be glad to, you know, if we need to schedule a workshop and to dig into the numbers further. This is your budget now. This is not the manager's. The manager has made the recommendation, and now it's yours.
So last year at the budget hearing, I remember that Chairman Engel made a motion which included a lot of amendments and for changes in the budget to try to get that your recommended tax rate down and to accomplish what we needed to for our schools. And one of the things that he asked for, which we voted on to approve, was to cut into some of the contingency amounts that are built in various departments' budgets. Is that a possibility for this year?
We have 250.
Our contingency right now is budgeted at $70,720.
For all departments all together? I mean, that's not very much.
Yep.
Was it more than that last year?
It was slightly more than that going into the budget, but then it was reduced down to 43.9 due to the changes that were implemented there. A couple of departments do have a contingency line item, mostly SARA management, but their funds are strictly industry funds that do not go into the county revenues.
I'm really concerned about funding the Alamance Burlington school system at so much less than what they requested, because I know, and I go to their meetings, I know what they're requesting. They've already prioritized. I mean, they're not, you know, there's a six-point strategic plan, six goals, and what they're requesting is only addressing maybe half of those goals, and most of that is just on a couple of goals. And it's just, those are just so important to keep us moving forward. We've had all this great momentum, wonderful things happening with special programming. We're just starting to get maybe more competitive with the teacher pay supplements. Regardless of what the state does, you know, we're still, even if the state does what the Senate's proposing with teacher pay increases, we're still gonna be behind the eight ball competitively if the counties around us are paying higher supplements. I mean, that's it. And you know, I personally believe if we teach our kids with the best teachers in good facilities and teachers using the best teaching techniques, that the opportunities for our kids are just enormous for their own personal prosperity, and their prosperity is going to make our county prosperous. And it would eliminate, I tend to take the long view about things, but it would just have such an impact on our need for other things that we spend a lot of money on, like in our sheriff's department and our jail and DSS, sorry, Susan Osborne. We wouldn't need to spend so much money if every child went through our school, our public education system, ended up graduating, doing something postgraduate, getting a really good paying job, not minimum wage jobs, but good paying jobs, and the impact that would have in our community. I just think we need to figure out our priorities so that we can support what we need to do for ABSS.
And I agree, I'm fully aware that there's some concern from ABSS about the funding level. But also, we have increased funding to ABSS over the last couple of years, about $4 million. So
look where we started. I mean,
I agree. We cut them. There were years they got zero increase. There were years that they got cut. But it does go back that we made major steps last year, and what we're trying to look at this year is address a broad range of things. Again, going back to the pay and class study, we were looking at trying to a seven-year plan for implementation for our employees, well, to get them to market. And now we have cut that. It'll probably be 8-9 years before we get our employees to market. So it really is trying to balance out all the needs.
I understand. We have a lot of needs.
Yes, sir. Yes. Very much so.
A lot of needs.
Well, all of the school systems in the state are having problems getting teachers because we're not turning out enough teachers in our colleges. And I know Guilford County, I practiced law up there for 7 years, and I always kind of keep up with them. Guilford County, and they're paying more than we do, and they're still, I think, the last I heard, they had about 100 vacancies they can't fill. So, you know, we can't just keep spending and spending. I mean, you got to have priorities, and I don't mind spending for the sheriff and the EMS and CCOM and health department also. And yeah, we've got to support the schools, but I agree with the manager in the fact that last year the board took a big step for the schools, and I think it helps. We can't do that every year. I mean, we got people out here, they say the tax rate is somewhat 5%. Well, that's, I mean, not unemployment rate is around 5%. That's not true, because so many people have just stopped looking for jobs. The real unemployment rate is around 11 or 12%. And people just can't afford to continue paying more and more taxes.
All right.
Well, what I would suggest, if we do need a workshop, board members either let myself know or let the chairman know, and then we can schedule one. We need about 48 hours.
We'll have to move quickly.
Since we got the emergency, Clyde?
Every day.
Every day, Clyde is available for emergency. So, I do want to, again, I do want to thank you, and I do want to thank our department heads, and also do want to thank the schools. You know, again, this is minor steps for all. It's nothing major. You know, it's one of those things that my mom always said, if not everybody's happy, then you may be doing something right. So so hopefully that'll work out.
So short of a workshop, we can submit recommendations or possible changes to you?
What I would recommend is that if there are major recommendations that need to occur, it needs to be in a workshop. So because we're cutting the time frame fairly short this year on the 20th, or we can do it after the public hearing. You know, it's whatever the board so chooses. We're just cutting the time frame.
I think if we do a workshop, it needs to be prior to
the meeting. Yeah, I don't think we ought to do it after the 20th.
Right. So if the board's
agreed, we can leave that open, I guess, to that.
But if there's major changes, minor changes can be tweaked at the time. Major philosophical changes would need to be, my recommendation would be a workshop.
Okay. I'd be in favor of doing that.
Okay. Well, we'll just kind of work that out after between us or whatever with Craig and see the availability of time. I guess our next thing is to set this public hearing and vote on that, right?
Right.
Okay, I need a motion for that.
No move.
Okay. Set the public hearing and relocate the meeting to the old courthouse. Got a first and a second. Thank you, David. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, very good.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, sir.
I think you're still up, Craig.
Oh, I am.
Don't get relaxed.
We have, is this the DSS?
Yes.
We have two applicants for the board position. This is David Spool's position, who is coming off. Edna Parker and Dennis Boone have submitted their applications for that position. So it's a board decision on who you would like to see.
I nominate Edna Parker.
I'll second that.
All right, we got a first and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, very good. Thank you. All right. Next, we have county manager report. I think you just did it, didn't you?
The only thing that I need so. To in looking at our strategic plan is to set a date for the workshop for that with Lydia Altman and where's with, oh, I could see her behind Clyde. What dates were we looking at again?
We're looking at Monday, June 27th, Wednesday, the 29th, or Thursday, the 30th, which was. And it will be from 9 to 2.
It will include lunch.
It will include lunch.
Well, I include lunch. Okay. I'm okay with Monday.
Is the Monday fine?
Monday, okay, 27th.
Okay. Monday, we have a stepping up task force meeting planned that morning.
Okay.
That's going to be a big meeting.
28th work?
the 28th.
I think you had a conflict, or was it Craig had a conflict?
I think I had a conflict on the 28th.
We're moving to the 29th very rapidly.
I'm good for the 29th.
Okay. Craig, we're going to have it on the 29th.
The 29th, yes, sir.
Let's go for 30.
Meeting's on 20. No, this is for
strategic.
This is the strategic planning.
The results.
This is
strategic planning.
Yeah. All right. 29. And that's all I have.
Okay. Very good. Next, we're going to have comments from the public. Dr. Harrison, you're first up. So I don't know if you're ready for this or not. Now, you probably
are. I am. Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chair and Commissioners and Craig. First of all, let me say I appreciate the position you find yourselves in. Limited dollars and an awful lot of needs and an awful lot of people hollering at you and to you. So I do appreciate that and respect the job that you do. And Craig, I'm not mad with you.
I know.
I'm disappointed and surprised. And I'm surprised because we've had multiple conversations over the past couple of months about what this budget was going to look like. And this does not come anywhere close to what we talked about. And so that really caught me off guard when I got a phone call on Friday afternoon, and really sends us back to the drawing board. And I think it's coincidental that Mr. Bell came up here and did a great job talking about return on investment. And coincidental that we had workforce development here, and also Brian Baker coming and talking a little bit about the Hard River Trail. Because a community can make no better investment of its dollars than in its children. And that's what we're talking about. If we invest in our children, then the work of the workforce development group becomes a little bit easier. And interesting that Brian was here because the last 2 years we've begun our teacher leadership academy at Saxapaw, and Brian has been with us to share about the vision of the Hog River Trail and how that's taking shape. And you've heard about the vision of Saxapaw and how that's taken some time. And we have a vision for public education in Alamance County. And an awful lot of people invested an awful lot of time and sweat and heart into that vision. And we've developed a strategic plan that I think, I'm certain, will make that vision a reality. And you showed some courageous leadership last year and invested in the first step of that strategic plan. And I recognize that, and conversations that I've had with Craig and some of you, that we said this year we'd come to you and we'd back off a little bit on this, the pace of our strategic plan. But we felt that we couldn't back off in two areas in particular. That's taking care of our people and our specialized programs to make sure that we meet the needs of all of our youngsters. And Judge Smith, you're right that there is a teacher shortage across the state of North Carolina. Guilford is short on teachers, but they pick them up from Alamance County on a fairly regular basis. Of those who left us last year to go to another school system to teach, 43% went to Guilford, Durham, or Orange County. Our five-year plan was to get our supplements on pace with them. We had 1% last year. We wanted to add 1% this year, which is about $1.8 million. One of those counties, I think it was Guilford, is looking at a 3% increase for their supplements, so it's going to have to accelerate for us to, is that my time?
Right? No, you're fine.
To keep pace. And as I think about the $1.3 million, 500 of it going to facilities or capital outlay, that will take care of our painting of our five schools this summer. That's about $470,000 that we've already bid. So that leaves $800,000. It's about 1.8, as I said, to give a supplement increase of 1% to our 1,800 teachers. We have about $400,000 that we've obligated to specialized programs based on conversations that I've had with the county manager over the year. So that leaves us with about $300,000 left to expand. And not sure where that'll go. It won't help our people. We're cutting positions as opposed to expanding positions. I think we've cut one director position going into next year at the central services. We've taken three centrally based personnel in student services, and we're moving those out to the schools. So I don't think we've been extravagant by any stretch of the imagination. I think we've been very sensitive to understanding the dilemma that Craig faces and that you as commissioners face. But I think I would be shortchanging our students and the community if I didn't come and let you know that I'm very, very, very disappointed. We made a stride. I'd say almost a giant stride last year in the implementation of the strategic plan. And this budget does not even, it's a status quo. And we all know that organizations move one or two ways. They move forward and they move backwards. So if we're not moving forward, which we're not with this budget, we're losing pace on the field. And our kids don't deserve that. Monday morning is about the busiest morning for my senior staff, but we're all here this morning because we want you to know how important we think this is. Our board members have an awful lot on their plates, and at the 11th hour, 5 of 7 of them were able to show up this morning. I think that we've got a great relationship with the county manager and the county finance officer, and I think with the commissioners as well. And again, I'm not mad with you, but I'm disappointed. And hope that we would be invited to sit at the table if you do have a work session and talk a little bit about, in a little more in depth about what we're doing. I would ask that you go back to the PowerPoint that I presented to you a month or so ago and take a look at where that $3.2 million increase goes. We just need more than $1.3 million. I appreciate the opportunity to share my thoughts with you, and again, I do appreciate the position in which you find yourself, and I'd be happy to respond to any questions.
Well, first off, thank all of your folks for being here, and the school board, thanks for your participation being here today, and it's a tough position we're in, too, and the voters made a choice in the primary and showed kind of what they wanted, and unfortunately, it was not a tax increase, I think. I think I was partially a direct result of that. And just in thinking of that, you know, we got a it is a balancing act. And I got a grandchild, Elon, graduating kindergarten today. And you know, I have an investment in this county. I have grandchildren in our schools, and they're important to me, too. But we have to kind of figure out how to juggle these balls and put everything together. And
I understand. Thank you.
All right, next we have Tony Cox.
Y'all can add in about $3.5 million for about 10 years on my behalf, and we'll be good. Frank Bell was talking about the tax department. I had to date this when I picked it up, 7/13/07. The Alamance County Tax Department only has license for beer, wine, and fortune telling. We don't carry any other at this present time. And in September of 2007, your county attorney got up and he said he wants you to believe that somebody somewhere told him. It was a lie. Straightforward. We got some more lies here. I ain't even gonna open this. You know what's funny? I go down there to Raleigh and I tell them I want the files and I want it certified and I want it certified that everything in there is full and accurate. And I didn't get this part of it. And I made it clear what I wanted. And then whenever I send them an email, to me the tone of the email is hostility. But, hey. I just asked the questions. I didn't ask for the fraud. I did not ask for it. As a matter of fact, I've done everything to try to stop it. And the fraud has gone on since then. But your Bible says, thou shalt not lie. That part of the Ten Commandments probably don't matter. The stealing part, that part don't matter. As long as this government killing, stealing, and doing what they do, it's okay. But you know, they talk about this education thing. I remember I quit high school because Harry Comer was going to hit me with a stick. And I said, no, I'm 16 years old, I'm not going to be hit with a stick. And that guy that I hear that was such a great guy, Freeman, said, oh, it's probably best that he just go ahead and quit. Now, I had the smarts. The teachers just didn't know how to bring it out. They didn't care. Now, if my daddy would have been somebody in government or something, oh, they'd have figured it out. I hear these people coming in here talking about all these programs and stuff. I've been coming to these meetings 9 years. How many people's offered me? None. But hey, I'm just a throwaway like I've been all my life. Poor people, that's what they are, they're throwaways. Family Justice, they come in here and talked about, oh, they've got them a mascot of who they helped. But hey, and I'll just keep on coming, I guess, because I can't work no more, so I'm going to be getting on you. I'll be getting, you know, living in poverty even worse. I'll be having to sign up for your programs and stuff and probably be denied, and everybody be saying, oh, what did he do? I just have to say a pathetic bunch. But hey, somebody forgot their
comment. That's Frank's there. Handed to me.
More junk.
All right. Any commissioner comments?
Yeah, I'd like to say I think the budget is pretty good. I when you put $5 million in fund balance, I have from fund balance, I do, it scares me, it always has, but we have been using it in the past and for years never used a dime of it, and I hope that's the way that it'll be. I won't be here next year whenever you either have to use it or not use it. But as far as the schools are concerned, I always have supported the increase in teacher supplement. I've always tried to get it to be classroom teachers only, and I think that's the way it ought to be, period. I have a grandchild in the system now also, so I feel for the school system, and I think this board has supported the school system and continues to support the school system, and I think that the chairman is correct. I think the public answered what they felt like in the primary, and we need to go by that. We need to continue to listen to the public. That's all I have to say about it.
Anybody else? With that, we will be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.